Welcome to the new Aeon, Age of Aquarius, rising on the eastern horizon on the winter solstice, quadrature to Leo in summer, to Scorpio in spring, and to Taurus in autumn, the rising sign of the ecliptic zodiac changes every Aeon. A span of 2,000 years, the ecliptic zodiac has 12 signs, and so we count a span of 24,000 years as 12 Aeons. And two such cycles comprise an ice age per hemisphere, 48,000 years. The North Pole freezes because the negative electromagnetic pole desalinates the salt water oceans that for 48,000 years. The South Pole freezes because the negative EM pole reverses to there and produces the same effect on the waters in the South Pole region. Ice ages are not sudden, they progress according to seasons, and these are determined in turn by Earth's location and its orbital duration around the sun and star, and where it flickers and varies. We had more when it goes through the aphelion aspects of its ellipse. An ice age season lasts 12,000 years, and there are four per ice age per hemisphere. This is why the zodiac of Aeons is 12,000 years. Years each eon in this era. As we enter the age of Aquarius, Aeon, we are entering the Aeon for the North Hemisphere and the mid-spring Aeon for the South Hemisphere and the dawn of each Aeon. Seven planets align in a grand cross formation with the other three outermost planets. Our own Earth and Moon aligning with the Sun at the centermost crux of the cross pattern. This marks the beginning of the transition across the eons. The end is marked by the alignment of the Sun and its planetary orbital ecliptic plane, the black hole at the core of the spiral Milky Way galaxy in the constellation Sagittarius A. The grand cross alignment occurred most recently on the 5th of May in the year 2000, and the ending alignment of the Sun and the Milky Way's black hole occurred on December 20th, 11:59, 59, and 21st at 12 midnight. Between them and was predicted by the Mayans as the day when Balamiote, their equivalent of the blue star Kachina of the North American Hopi tribe, would unveil its revelation. Between these events, the beginning and ending alignments, there are significant geopolitical and religious events. Astrology bears its greatest influence on the masses, swaying public opinion more easily at such moments of greatest historical pitch. Between timelines, the better and the worst dimension are overlapping one another and visibly impacting in a third dimensional space. Alternate cosmos is alike, our own one above and one below. Membranes interface gradually coming into convergence and then being torn apart again. These other Earths revolve around the same mainstream timeline, our own, and their distance away from or proximity to our own influences. The sunspot cycle, its plasma ejections, the electromagnetic fields of planets, and these inside the brains of any beings living on them like ourselves with brains to experience these subtle changes in invisible mental radio waves. Every 1,000 years, these parallel dimensional realities overlap one another, and every other 1,000 years, they are furthest apart from one another. In 2000, they overlapped, and in 1500, they were torn as far apart as they can be. In 1000 AD, they had converged again, and in 500 AD, were once again at their peak and valley positions in nominal year zero during the lifetime. We are told of Christianity's Lord and Savior, these timelines converged again, and in 500 BC they were split from one another, having converged before then. Last in 1000 BC, the era we learn from archaeology of ancient Babylon, so to now in 2000 AD, we see these events, the planets align, and then the sun and the galaxy's core as well, and so we understand that 7,000 years of peace between the angels of the skies and the demons of the lava flows beneath us. So in the future of the better timeline, humanity evolves to become more spiritual and reaccesses the crystalline geo-computing grid built by our Paleolithic ancestry. And in the worst timeline, the opposite occurs. Humanity devolves and assumes more animalistic forms and fates, dividing into factions among them, slid between the first reptilians and insectoids, then into avian overfeline and feline factions, then into mice and elephants, and finally into the feline faction of them all. And then in AD 3000, the beast will be unleashed again, and the lower one will rise into the higher dimension. When the lower dimensional dwellers tear open rift between their own realm and the higher world, on the surface of the earth, if our own world, the middleware, and mystery timeline no longer exists, then this will destroy both of the Earth's in these parallel timelines. However, it may be possible for them both to outlive the destruction of Earth until then. If our Earth were to be hit by the asteroid of Apophis 99922 on April 15th, this could occur as predicted if we do not deflect this asteroid before then. Our Earth, the mainstream timeline, only allows these alternate dimensions to coexist across and within it, and so without it they will cross paths and implode in such a way that could threaten the surrounding cosmos. And ultimately, more than this, alter the natural course of events for the entire. But these are trying times here on our Middle Earth, where the reptilian faction of the worst timeline are plotting, planning, and scheming to suppress the remaining mammalian populations, to mock them and feed the gap and to hide in tunnels below these tubes. Hard to broadcast long-range sound weapon laser beams to superheat distant locations. These insidious con artists are war criminals. Politicians that can easily be arrested for their crimes against humanity. If they are, then humanity will discover their black budget underground technologies. And reverse engineering UFO technologies can be outsourced to the public, and all will possess mental-only manifestation abilities and time travel machines. Until then, we await in this incarnation, prolonged by science or not, in any more lives to follow it for the realm to come that will define us during this dawning of the new